Okay, and welcome to the show. Hello, good morning, perhaps good evening, maybe good night, depending on where you're watching this. And I have a beautiful cup of something delicious here. I hope you have something similar. And as I announced yesterday, we're having a really cool show today because we have here, well, not in Amsterdam in the studio, I would say, but via interweb connection, we are joined by Charlie Enright of 11th Hour Racing, skipper and I guess team boss also. And we're going to have hopefully a very nice conversation about, you know, what they're up to and all of the cool technical insights that he may give us into the current Vendee and of course many of you know, the projects that he's working on right now with the 11th Hour Race team. So I'm very curious, I'm sure you are all very curious. But first, you have also something over there, right, Charlie? Are you joining for the toast?
Yeah. It's morning over here in Rhode Island, so I got my
there
own
There we go. App. Okay, shall we, okay, here we go. 3, 2, 1, and... Oh, that's good on a Saturday morning, I guess, when we're all watching this together. Okay, well, very warm welcome to the show, Charlie. Really happy that you can make time for us today. And yeah, to kind of barge in with the door, I'm sure you're also following the current Vendee Globe pretty closely. What's your, I'm going to just leave it very open from the start. Like, what are your impressions so far? What are you seeing? What are you noticing? Tell us a little bit about your Vendee Globe experience as captain of course, you know, one of the teams with a similar ship. I'm very curious to see your insights so far.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, I guess thanks for having me, and enjoyed that sip of coffee we have here in Rhode Island, what we call the coffee cup salute. So
very nice cup also, by the way, I have to say, very stylish.
Ask my wife about that. But anyway, back to the Vendee Globe.
Yeah,
you know, it's been a crazy race thus far for a lot of reasons. You know, battle of attrition, certainly. Reliability has proven to be you know, one of the biggest factors. I mean, the fleet is slowly dwindling away, you know, and there's some guys that have had some breakages that are certainly further back than they'd like to be. The weather in the South Atlantic was a little atypical, and now they're settling into the Southern Ocean, so it'll be interesting to see how the fleet adapts just from a performance standpoint, you know, whether they're, you know, pushing down there, they're just trying to, you know, keep status quo, throttle back a little bit. It'll be interesting to see the strategies, you know, not only as it relates to the weather and the fleet, but just kind of this survivability, if you will. Because the old adage, to finish first, you must first finish, has never really been more true than it is in this race.
Definitely. Yeah. What do you think about the speed of the race so far? Because they are obviously quite a bit behind on, you know, what happened in the previous edition. How do you view that? Just a case of, you know, less favorable weather, I guess, as you say, a little bit atypical in Atlantic so far. But how do you view, like, overall the boat performance as far as, you know, how they are kind of sailing so far?
Yeah, I mean, the boats have the ability to go quite quick, I mean, which we've seen at times, you know, doing 500 miles a day and whatnot with one person on board. I mean, that's no joke. So I'd attribute it mostly to weather, but you know, at the same time, there is a ceiling for what the human body can endure, you know, so these boats can only get pushed so hard. So, you know, ripping 500 mile days continuously for 70 days around the world is just, well, I guess it wouldn't be 70 days if you're doing 500 a day, but you know what I mean? Like 2 months of 500 mile days on the body is pretty hard. And preserving the gear, you know, a lot of these boats are built delicately, shall we say, on displacement, especially when the goal is to lift it up and out of the water. And I think you're seeing, you know, some breakages associated with the philosophy, you know, behind this boat and this fleet.
Yeah. Do you think that, because I actually read a comment by Jean Lacam on, you know, the foiling versus non-foiling thing, quite interesting. Jean Lacam, you know, doing very well in this race, of course, so far on his non-foiling boat. But he kind of said that, you know, concerning Teda in the beginning of the storm, that it was basically only him and Alex Thompson who actually, you know, went for the heart of the storm and really put that to their favor, while all of the young bucks, let's say, in the new boats were, you know, holding back a little bit. What do you think of that aspect of the race as far as style? Like, we have a lot of lesser experienced racers, let's say, than these, you know, two old dogs in the race, but they also seem to be holding back a little bit with the new boats. What do you think about that?
Yeah, it just comes down to who you are and what your risk tolerance is. I mean, Jean Lacam's had you know an amazing race to date, and you know, just what he went through with Kevin is nothing short of amazing. And I'm sure we'll cover that later. But you know, just hats off to him, the race he sailed and the actions that he's taken over the last you know, call it week. But the conditions have certainly been favorable, I guess, for an older boat like his. And I guess to some degree, if he's pushing 100% in something that might not be as fast, and somebody else is pushing 80% in something that's maybe a decade newer, you know, that's the result. But, you know, his boat's been to that part of the world. It's been through storms of that nature before. So he knows it, I'm sure, better than these other guys know. You know, the tools that they have at their disposal today. So I think you see them, you see some trepidation there. And it's also, you know, it was really early in the race. You know, you can't win it in the first 10 days, but you can certainly lose it, which we've seen. And I think to some extent, Charlie and Toma have been rewarded for how they've sailed their boat. And, you know, all it takes is one bad jive in the middle of that low. But when you're Jean Lacam and you've done 1,000 jives at sea, you know, in this boat solo in the Vendee Globe, you know, you can do it with more confidence. And I think, like I said, the weather in the South Atlantic was a little light, which doesn't really suit the foilers relative to some of the, you know, displacement boats, kind of whatever you want to call them. And then, you know, I said earlier, you know, if he can just sneak into the Southern Ocean where everybody's going to be throttled back, I mean, Jean Lacam's going to be relevant here for a long time.
Yeah. Not to get too technical on you too quickly, but how much do you think the mast breakage of Quorum, pretty early in the race, relatively speaking, and the fact that there's this thing with the foilers now where basically, you know, normally if your boat doesn't have the ability to foil, you know, if the mast really gets overpowered, you will generally, you know, broach and you'll turn into the wind, basically. But the foiling boats, as I understand it, don't necessarily have that option because they're kind of locked, like, you know, like a rail into the water, which allows actually for the boats to get into a position where the mast gets overpowered. So normally it would depower by itself because you just go over and you turn into the wind. But because the boats essentially can't turn over, you can go over the tolerance of the mast actually a lot easier than if your boat wasn't foiling. Do you think that also factors into the maybe a little bit, you know, more carefulness of the foilers on that aspect, and especially after the mast breaking, that they are, you know, all holding back maybe quite a bit more because of that also?
Yes. you know, is the one word answer, but the, you know, these masts were conceived you know, before foiling was a thing.
Exactly. And, you
know, it's definitely the fuse in the system. You know, it was designed to a particular writing moment, and you know, writing moment in the olden days used to be generated through the keel and the bulb and the stack and all that stuff, and now the writing moment is generated you know, through the foils. And how exactly that writing moment is measured is a little unclear, you know, how to go about getting you know, the best reading, because it's a combination of all the forces that I just outlined, and then on top of that you have you know, foil loads they're calculated with fiber optics. You got fiber optics in the rig now, you know, you got load cells on all of the tack pins and head stays and, and have you. So I mean, trying to extrapolate what writing moment you're sailing at any given time is a difficult thing to do. And I think knowing the red line for every single sail case and every single, you know, angle and true wind speed is going to be one of the biggest things in this class moving forward, just knowing where that line is. It's one thing to say, I'm pushing or I'm not pushing, but that's all relative to a particular state that you need to have confidence in.
Yeah. Interesting. And since we're sort of making the transition towards at least the damages so far in the Vendee Globe, actually, relatively few damages. So we have 3 retirements so far. Last edition, we had 5 by now. So in that sense, we're still doing good. But especially, of course, the case of PRB, you already mentioned it here before. How are you looking at that particular breakage? I mean, I can almost imagine you running to the carbon store saying, guys, we better reinforce these longitudinals a little bit right away. But what's your input on that?
There are, there's a lot of facts, I guess, or stories, around the heroics, that occurred that night, but there's not a ton on the incident itself, what actually transpired. And I'm sure it's tough for Kevin to figure out exactly what happened because it all happened over the course of this, finite amount of time. It just 2 minutes, it sounds like the boat went from sailing along at 27 knots to, on the verge of sinking. But yes, as someone that has a boat currently under construction, you call the people that are responsible for things like that. You make sure that we're covered, and we're not skimping in areas that relate to reliability. I don't know a ton about that boat, but I do know that it's an older generation and that it was retrofit for foil. So exactly how that came about, the engineering around the foil boxes, the writing moment there, where the deck was built, how it was built, were there any incidents, leading up to the start of the Vendee Globe? But traditionally, that's a lighter, grandfathered, older, boat. Mm-hmm. And, if there ever was a guy to be sailing it's Kevin. Cause he's all over it. Just as far as the sailing of the boat, the design, the boat building, the reinforcement, he is really a jack of all trades. You read everything online and he hadn't done, a ton of single-handed sailing prior to the Vendee, but he has done miles and miles and miles of relevant sailing on tons of Grand Prix boats. And, the guy's a total stud. So if anyone was going to be able to do it, it's, it's him. And it's unfortunate that certainly the boat let him down, but he is, one of the luckiest guys alive. And, just the whole story and the recovery process is nothing short of amazing. And, it was eggshells, certainly for me, someone who's of similar age, who's done a lot of crude sailing and is looking at, doing more shorthanded sailing going forward. It was a tough time, certainly for everybody. And, I know Kevin decently well, but certainly not as well as some of the other folks in France that we're working with on a daily basis. And, the whole community really ground to a halt, and rightfully so. And, Jean McCam was absolutely amazing in what he was able to accomplish.
Yeah. And how amazing is it, kind of a double twist, that he was saving PRB now when it was previously PRB, of course, that, saved him when he broke his ship off Cape Horn. That's one of those symmetries in life, I guess, that you couldn't have made it up if you tried to, very, yeah. Very interesting.
What goes around comes around, and it just goes to show you you're rewarded, for doing the right thing in the long run over time.
Yeah.
When incidents like this occur, there's a lot of learning and there's a lot of takeaway. You see changes in rules and safety. I'm just thinking about grab bags and escape patches and life rafts. And, it's going to be interesting to see what comes out of it. And, one person's near miss is hopefully something that can help the chances of others in the future.
Yes. And a very nice bridge to our next subject, Charlie, because, right now, of course, you've already, I think, quite modified, the 11th hour one, I guess you're calling it your current boat, which is the previous Hugo boss from the last Vendee. But you're working on a new ship, as you just mentioned. And interesting, because as I understand it, of course, you know, the Volvo or the Ocean Race, I guess it's called now, of course, postponed by a year. So a little bit more time, I guess, also for you to really get into the new boat. But how are you kind of taking the lessons from this Vendee, but also of your previous, you know, experience on that boat into kind of the new concept that you're building now, as it's probably going to take much more into account the team aspect of the Ocean Race versus the more shorthanded or even single-handed Vendee racing that they're very used to doing. And can you talk a little bit about, you know, that transition, let's say?
Certainly. You know, as you outlined, we've been sailing around in what we refer to as 11-1, which is the 2015 ex-Hugo Boss. And, you know, I jumped into the French Imoca scene with 2 feet head first, if you could do that, in Brittany and participating in the pole training sessions and doing the TJV with, Pascal. And, it was just such a learning experience for me, whether it's the foiling or the autopilot or, you know, doing things on the boat that I'm not accustomed to doing. But that's going to be the nature of, what's ahead of us, whether it's crewed sailing with 2 people, whether it's crewed sailing with, 4 people, 5 people, you're going to be asked to do a lot more. You're not going to be able to push the boat the way that we're used to pushing it with crews of, say, 8 to 10. Mm-hmm. Specialty positions, if you will, are kind of out the window. Everyone's got to do a little bit of everything and be responsible for more areas of the boat, because there's still just as much stuff to do. Mm-hmm. There's fewer people to do it. We've modified the boat a little bit, but I'd say not as much as you'd think. It's more of a test platform for performance than it is, crude amenities. What your sleeping bag looks like and how much space you got in the cockpit probably isn't going to win you the next crewed ocean race. It's going to be the things hanging out the side and the things flapping around in the air. So a lot of the focus has been on foils and sails, and where we've been able to kind of pick up some of the more livability features, we've done so. But again, the focus has been on getting the boat, around the world reliably, and also the speed at which we're able to do that.
I'm curious, because you have, of course, a very strong background with the Volvo, finishing that twice, doing very, very well. How do you, do you also bring some of the crude Volvo experience to this class? Has that also kind of informed a little bit, and maybe also added, there's a lot, where we could say that the Imoca class is maybe ahead of the Volvo 60s, or is like the next step. But you being super experienced with that class, are you also really taking some ideas from there and kind of incorporating that more into the Imoca class, where that maybe wasn't there before?
Certainly. The next round the world race, the ocean race, is going to be a fusion of these kind of Franco-Anglo worlds, certainly the Imocas are more performance oriented and sophisticated than the Volvo 65s were, and to some extent, the 70s that preceded them. But then again, that was 10 years ago. But the concept of, pushing hard and, having a boat that's up to snuff, that's up to the standard. What's the point, I guess, of making a fragile plaything that can only be pushed so hard if you can make it a little heavier and a little bit more robust and go to the places on the earth that get you around it faster than, like if you'd taken your foot off the gas. So there's a little bit of that, certainly. I think how that dynamic is managed, the crude dynamic, if you will, the more traditional ocean racing, with multiple people on board versus what's happening in France right now, is going to be, the key to success in some of these crude races moving forward.
And are there any particular concept, like I understand, of course, that you cannot give too much away, but is there anything from the concept of the new boat that you're building that you can share with us already, like that you can talk about a little bit, give us a little bit, a little tip of the...
Well, not a ton, to be honest. It was, and that's not because
we're talking about anything,
but I think the success of this concept is centered around how similar some of the shorthanded boats can be relative to the crude boats. You have to optimize and deviate from the Imoca rule that exists right now. This concept's going to be dead on arrival. So, the more these two lines can come together and you can get a boat that's capable of doing both, that's going to be the key to success, certainly.
Nice. And you are planning to launch the boat in June, if I'm not mistaken, or that's the plan?
Yeah, end of June, early July, which is certainly later than we'd originally anticipated. But given the COVID situation and the delay in the race and
Yeah, but still a doable timeline. And of course, we have some extra time before the ocean race now. But, I guess you're also focusing, in between that time on building as much experience with the boat, with the new boat as possible. So what is the program going to be looking like, once the boat hits the water?
We're going to be focusing on the 2021 Imoca schedule, which mm-hmm. is, essentially the Ocean Race Europe. And if that all works out with us, I guess in the old platform, because the new platform won't be done yet. Mm-hmm. That's supposed to be May and the better part of June. And then the Fastnet race, the Rolex Fastnet race, and the Defi Azimut, and the TJV.
And you have on the boat that you have now already installed the current generation foils, as I understand it. And you've been sailing with those for a while. Are you going to sort of take the concept that you've developed there and take that to the new boat? Or are you evolving that concept from there?
Oh, I think it's ever evolving. I mean, there's the empirical data that we were able to collect with the new foils on this boat, certainly. Mm-hmm. But then there's a element of simulation and science and design, which is, a lot of it's over my head. But, as team members, we do use the, the simulator as a way to kind of get reps and collect data when we're unable to be on the water. And then there's observation, what we see in the Vendee Globe and when the boats are sailing around and, in a fleet, whether it's the Vendee Globe or the Vendee Arctic or the Azimut. I mean, there's been a lot of fleet racing to observe. Our design concepts are, I guess, a hybrid of all those different things.
Yeah. And are you, of course, you're looking very closely at the Vendee now. We see this UFO or Sofni problem, of course, persisting. I take it you're probably also working with the Oscar system, maybe in the current boat already, or at least probably in the new boat. How do you see that evolving in the future? I had a good conversation with Will Harris from the Sea Explorer about it last week, talked about it quite in depth. But he also mentioned that the system's still relatively basic in the sense that it can, turn the boat into the wind a little bit if it detects something, but it's still pretty short range. And seeing again that we have probably at least two people, retire, and Jeremy, is fortunately still in the race, but also likely hit something. How do you see this evolving? And are you also very actively involved in that particular challenge of the race? Because it's so... devastating, of course, when it happens to the entire program.
Yeah, there's a lot out there, for sure. And I guess kind of starting at the top, we do have the Oscar unit installed on our boat, and we have for the entirety of 2020. Mm-hmm. The Ocean Race rule does mandate a collision avoidance system. It's not currently specified, but Oscar definitely seems to be the most prevalent amongst the fleet. And that is, there's kind of two phases to it. There is the identification of an object itself done, visually as an anomaly or, through infrared or, and whether it's on and you know, potentially collecting false positives. I mean, it, just taking pictures of the ocean and the machine learning process. I mean, you're giving back to the Oscar concept just by having it on and recording the data and then constantly improving it over time. And then I think the second that Will was referencing was the avoidance and the connection to the autopilot. You know, which one you're saying by yourself is a huge deal because your ability to respond is severely compromised. But you know, there are other things out there as well. You know, there's pingers that you can put in the keel, which, you know, send out acoustic and make noise to deter marine mammals from, you know, coming near the boat. And then there's also, you know, there's sonar as well. You know, a lot of these systems are cutting edge and sophisticated and works in progress. And it's tough to get tangible results, you know, if you don't hit anything, were you just lucky or was the system working? It's really tough to say, but you know, certainly given the severity of some of these issues, you know, everybody and ourselves included should be trying to do everything in our power to avoid them. And I think specifically marine mammal strikes, you know, that's a huge part of our campaign. You know, just on the sustainability side, I mean, we have marine mammal briefings before, you know, most of our long passages to know, you know, what we can expect, where the breeding grounds are. You know, we are constantly tracking, you know, what we see and reporting it back to different outfits like the, you know, Oceanographic Institute of Woods Hole or the Audubon Society here in Rhode Island. So, you know, we're working with partners to try to, you know, help record and track what we see.
The hard part
is the stuff that you don't see.
Yeah, of course. And there is obviously still very invisible stuff out there. Otherwise, we wouldn't have two boats, you know, being hit now, possibly maybe three. Do you think that that the investment in that is also probably going to go like up again? Because we've seen the development with the autopilots really taking a lot of, you know, really take flight over the last two editions, let's say. But especially for this edition, it's gotten a lot of attention. And there's just a lot more development in there. I talked also about Will, you know, about the fact that the investment in autopilot sometimes rivals or even supersedes the investment that teams are making in sales. So the importance is really, really high. Do you think that the development in these detection, collision avoidance systems is also quickly, you know, as the results can be so devastating, maybe also growing?
Certainly. I mean, it's a binary phenomenon, you know, being able to finish or not being able to finish. And I think, you know, if you told some of these guys that have, you know, had misfortune and hit something here in the entrance to the Indian Ocean, if they could have, you know, had a detection system or one less sail, I think it's pretty clear what you would do. You know, if you had a system with high confidence and you could avoid some of these race ending mistakes, I mean, that's money well spent, certainly.
Yeah. Okay. So I think let's make the bridge also to a bit more the sustainability side. Because yesterday, actually, with the Seawolves, we did a whole program on UFOs and softnies and the different things, of course, that are in the water. So, you know, whales, wood, of course, also a lot of driftwood, always big problem. And of course, plastic, which you guys are very much, you know, raising awareness for. Can you talk a little bit about, you're doing, of course, a considerable amount of science. You both did that in the ocean race, doing that right now. And I'm sure that in the new boat, you're also, again, pushing the limits there. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, what you guys are doing now? You already mentioned it a little bit. And also what the next generation also within the Imocas is of, you know, different science experiments that you are planning on bringing around and helping in, you know, maybe collision avoidance a little bit, but also just, you know, cleaning up of the plastic that, of course, is a big problem for all of us.
Certainly. You know, there's the onboard science portion of our campaign that you referenced. And, you know, we every time the boat's been sailing in 2020, we're constantly collecting water samples and, you know, testing, you know, the temperature, the salinity, the dissolved CO2. You know, other boats in the past have tracked the amount of microplastic in the water. And it's, you know, the results that we've seen are you know, pretty ridiculous for remote parts of the world. And if it's marine debris, if it's marine mammals, you know, once you get into the Southern Ocean, I mean, the stuff just continuously goes around the bottom of the planet. I mean, there's no land, there's no continents, there's nothing for it to run into. So it's, you know, a hindrance to navigation, certainly, but, you know, also a big contributor to climate change. And one of the big focuses of our campaign is, you know, the health of our oceans relative to the health of our planet. So, you know, there's the onboard science aspect of the campaign. There's the, you know, investment on the operations side. I mean, every single decision that we make, whether it's, you know, what materials we're going to use in our boat build or, you know, what hotel we're going to stay at relative to the race village so we can walk versus drive. I mean, it, you know, sustainability factors into every single decision that we make, as a program. And I think that, being able to track, you know, our own personal footprint and then our team footprint so that we have a benchmark for future improvement is also a big, you know, important part of our campaign on the operations side. And then, you know, you talked a little bit about the next generation and, you know, the Grant Legacy program is a very rewarding part of our campaign as well, where we're working with that next generation and all the places and the communities that we go to try to leave a long lasting change, because, you know, in a lot of ways, particularly with the ocean race will show up to a particular place. It'll stay for a couple weeks, then it'll pack itself up and head on out. And, you know, to be able to go back to some of these places and to see some of the relationships that we've formed, you know, take shape over time and the longevity of those now has been really rewarding. You know, for me personally, being here, in Rhode Island training for 6 weeks at the end of the summer, being able to engage with some, you know, local grantees here, whether it's, you know, Healthy Soils, Healthy Seas of Rhode Island and the composting initiative, or it's Clean Ocean Access and, you know, the shrink wrapping initiative that they've been working on. I mean, our team is in a very unique and powerful position, you know, as athletes and as ambassadors, but also members of the marine industry to kind of help create change within and to lead by example, you know, with just our actions, but also some of the initiatives that we're partnered with.
And as I understand it, you are also, of course, you're taking sustainability basically into account on every aspect of the boat. Can you talk a little bit about how that's factoring in also into the building of the new boat? So what kind of sustainability aspects are you looking into there? And are there any new things that you're working on for your conduct during the race? Because I understand that, you know, right now, I think in the last edition of the Volvo Oso, you use, for example, reusable packs for food and, you know, supplies and all this type of things that can be washed instead of having to be thrown out. Very cool idea. Is there any evolvement in there also for the new boat, where maybe through design or permanent, you know, way of, you know, things that you put in the boat, that you're again raising the level to which the boat can, you know, be part of that sustainable practice of building and handling?
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, whether it's, you know, new materials, whether it's bioresins or it's use of flax as a composite material, you know, we're trying to build non-structural parts of the boat with new sustainable boat building methods. And it's something that, you know, we've done collaboratively with our partners, you know, as part of the Ocean Summit series. You know, we've had a sustainable boat building consortium that's met at different places or around the world and done some idea sharing and really tried to move the needle on this, because, you know, it's no secret, you know, building carbon fiber race boats is not good for the planet, and to, you know, but we need to invest in these things and make them a priority to improve that moving forward. And that's a huge focus of our team, and we're trying to use our new boat as an example for some of those initiatives.
Nice. Are you aware, I mean, you're probably aware, but are you aware of this guy? I think he's German, who's making a vegan boat, who's doing, you know, plant-based carbon mats. And he actually made a sailboat with that, which is basically all the fiber in the boat is plant-based, which is very, very interesting. I don't know what the strength I don't know what the exact strength of it is in relation to carbon, but are you aware of that?
is it called Green Boats?
I think so. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So we, if it is Green Boats, we worked with them on making the escape hatch on our boat that's currently under construction. And, you know, I think volumetrically, you know, kind of pound for pound, kilo for kilo, you can get things lighter, if not lighter than, carbon fiber. But the problem, as you outlined, is the modulus of the material. Mm-hmm. To get the same strength, you know, you need to get a little heavier, but on a part that's not structural or load bearing, there's an opportunity there. Definitely.
Nice. Oh, that's really great to hear. That's fun. I met him at a sailing fair somewhere last year, I think. Very, very interesting. Cool that you're working with that. Then I think maybe cool to kind of go for the challenge for the future, and that can include the environmental side. But as far as design, because my audience is really interested in, you know, details around design and function and sort of technique, what do you think are kind of the three most important you know, design challenges that that the Vendee, but basically the Imoca class is facing right now in order to kind of get to the next level?
I talked earlier about foils and sails. You know, the I think those are the biggest areas of focus, certainly. You know,
What do you think about the, sorry to interrupt you, what do you think about the material discussion of the material of the foil? So like we've been having in the Seawolf group a lot of discussion, even with some high-end university professors in fluid dynamics getting involved, about the material choice for the foils. So we saw, for example, in Archaea now that, you know, when we look at the pictures of the damage, it's interesting that he hit something, but the damage is kind of on the, you know, on the aft end of the boat. So it's kind of compression damage if he hit something. Some people are saying like maybe if it had been aluminium, that might have not happened, or, you know, something more like lighter space materials, let's say, for the foils in particular, because they're so vulnerable. Are you guys in any way also having that discussion internally to, you know, maybe experiment with that or looking at this type of material choices, maybe based on, you know, the experience in the Vendee Globe also this year?
Yeah, I mean, something that we'd like to experiment with is a steel trailing edge. It's not currently, articulated, but it's not currently permissible. The modulus of the, you know, the fiber that you're using and the way in which you're laying it up, you know, has a lot to do with the strength and reliability of these foils. You know, they're expensive, and it is a huge issue for the class moving forward. And, you know, it's certainly the material that they're made out of, but it's also their size, their sheer span. So that's something I think the class is looking to limit moving forward, but also the construction method. Not only are they all custom one-off products, but they're very, very intricate. So just how you go about building them and the man hours involved, you know, it's quite the undertaking. And, you know, the price is one thing, but then the time it takes to make these things is a whole nother thing, because if you have an incident, it's 6 months before you can get something new into the boat. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's a Imoca rule that states that the boats have to be symmetric. So now you're just making a carbon copy, no pun intended, of, you know, what you had before, and you're unable to move forward with design and iteration. And, it's really tricky. And at one point there was a proposal on the table to put elevators in the class, elevators in the rudders, T-rudders. Mm-hmm. Think, you know, the boats could get more riding moment out of them and more stable flight, and the foils wouldn't have to be as big, and that could be a cost savings, ironically. You know, moving forward, that's still being toyed with. So, you know, watch this space. You know, you're on the leading edge some of this stuff, and it's important that you don't end up on the bleeding edge.
Yeah. And what about the human side? Because this is also something that I discuss with Will. The fact, of course, that the boats are so fast, but also can become really quite violent, you know, once you go kind of over that 25 knots limit, and depending on the sea state. What is your experience with that, and how do you view the, you know, the human inside this, of course, a very computerized technical design? How do you see the role of the of the skippers, of the sailor, especially, you know, moving forward with the development speed that we have now between the last Vendee and now. And if we look at, you know, the next one, like, how do you think that role is going to keep evolving?
I mean, the boats are nothing short of heinous. You know, that's no secret. Just the slamming zones, I guess, the impact zones of, you know, the Imocas between the 16 edition and the 20 edition have moved aft significantly as they fly more and more out of the water. And, you know, I think the discomfort of the skippers has probably increased exponentially as well. I referenced it before. I mean, there's only so much that the human body can take. You know, you don't see these boats being sailed in conditions like that at 100%, you know, 500, 550, 600. I mean, you look at the VPPs of some of these things and they should be ripping off, you know, 650 mile days. But it's just, it's intolerable, you know, at times, you know, regulating the ride height with foil deformation and, you know, I guess the enclosure is certainly good. You know, the ocean race is traditionally outside hanging off a steering wheel getting absolutely pummeled. I guess in theory, if you're, you know, down below and you're in your long johns nice and dry, you can push the boat harder, but are you the one pushing it or is the autopilot, you know? You know, can you actually see anything from down there? That's a whole nother issue. The visibility, I mean, that's in a lot of ways, we designed our new boat around the visibility of the helms person, because it was originally intended to be hand steered. And that's a rule that looks like it's kind of going by the wayside. You talked about autopilot investment. And I think, you know, the class is moving toward a one design autopilot solution, perhaps, you know, as a cost saving mechanism. So again, watch this space. I mean, it's, you know, the Imoca class is interesting. It's a very democratic process. So, sometimes you got to wait for everybody to kind of get around the world, reconvene and vote on these things. And everybody tends to vote in their own best interests, which is usually the resale value of their boat. It's tough to kind of figure out how it's all going to play, but obviously there's 33 boats racing around the world right now, and as far as I can tell, there's not a ton of other sailing going on. These guys do have it figured out, and got to give them credit for that, definitely.
Do you think that that also, like you mentioned, the idea that we have the more enclosed cockpits now, it's interesting to see that we have a PVI in the lead, had Hugo Boss in the lead for quite a while before, both of them fully enclosed boats. You know, there is an argument for the fact that a human who is fresher, more energy, will make better choices. So I think that definitely factors strongly into the end result at some point, right? Do you think that that might also happen with the foils, that that there is still maybe a lot to discover there? As for, I heard that the L'Occitane, for example, somehow has designed a foil that seems to be a lot more smoother of a ride. At least that's what some of the messages that I'm hearing about it. Do you think that there's also still a lot to gain in that department to sort of, you know, bring that extra comfort, maybe also at higher speed so that you can go faster in the end also?
Yeah, I think the smoothness of the ride relative to the sea state is exceptionally important. You know, we talk about that with foils. You know, what is the optimal steady state flat water simulated foil versus, you know, in real life, what you have to give up to get something a little bit more tolerant. You know, that's kind of in my mind one of the big million-dollar questions, so to speak. But, you know, the fresher the human is, the better they perform. I mean, that's no secret. I mean, the way that these boats incentivize, you know, low freeboard and, you know, aerodynamic structure on deck. I mean, it wouldn't be like standing up at a steering wheel in a Volvo 70. It would be like putting your head down on the deck and just taking it on the chin, you know? The freeboard is low, you know, the booms are low, the masts are low, kind of trying to force that CE down. So they're totally different animals, but, you know, getting back to the comfort thing, you know, we've tried absolutely everything on board from, beanbags to custom mattresses to bungee and bunks and springs. And, you know, I was seeing something that Tom Marion had coming off his boat the other day that he has, like, I think 3 or 4 different sleeping options depending upon the conditions, whether it's in his little fighter jet thing or the beanbag. Yeah. You know, so you got to get sleep. And, you know, whether it's just a 15-minute kip because you're sailing alone, or you can actually get into a watch system because you got a couple more people on board. Mm-hmm. It's no joke. If you're fresh, you're gonna be sailing the boat a lot better and a lot harder.
Are you guys also sometimes wearing the body armor? I heard from several of the sailors that they're sometimes literally, you know, kind of wearing body armor inside in order to not bump too hard into. Are you guys also doing that?
No, we haven't yet, but yeah, I think we've all taken our fair share of you know tumbles down below. It's funny when the boats are in the water. You know, we've all logged so many miles. You have a kind of like the sixth sense. You know, when the boat traditionally takes off a wave, you know when it's gonna, you know, touch back down, and you can brace yourself. But if the boat's just flying along and you can't sense the next wave coming and slamming into the boat 3/4 of the way after the trance, it's like, you know, how do you prepare for that?
How do you view the difference in handling? Because I also talked about this with Will, and he kind of also told me that, you know, basically under 14 knots the boat more or less operates as a boat used to, and then as soon as it starts foiling, it just becomes a completely different boat. You have to, you know, mitigate your sail area a lot quite quickly, and you can just keep building speed with a lot less sail area. Are you also developing as a team, maybe also with the sail shapes and all this type of more the flying end of the boat, let's say, a lot in order to be able to make that transition much more faster, let's say, that moment when you hit the foils and you start flying, to get kind of in optimal flying mode and switch between the two in a more efficient way? How is that factoring into the development now?
Yeah, there's a huge cliff, you know, in the performance curve. You know, if you're sitting at home right now, somebody who kind of traditionally sails like a, you know, asymmetric port boat or something like that, you talk about the difference between planing and not planing, being on the step, being that, you know, the difference between displacing and foiling is, you know, that 10x. So you're all the power you can get, and then it's shed the power. You know, you need a small efficient sail plan once you're up and going. You know, but how exactly you transition through that, it's not totally clear, and something that we are working on. You know, windage, once you're going in excess of 25, sometimes 30 knots, is a really big deal. But the opportunity cost of doing a sail change when you're doing 30 knots is also a big deal. So where's that crossover? You know, and you know, we're coming from a world where you got plenty of people on the boat to do inline sail changes and never slow down, and people on the bow. But I mean, you can't be on the bow of these boats with no freeboard while they're going 25 knots, you know, with the bow, you know, 2 meters out of the water. It's insanity. So to slow down and do that maneuver methodically has a big opportunity cost. So, you know, when do you just leave different sail sets up in the air, you know? And I think, you know, what you're asking each and every sail to do. You know, we spent a lot of time talking about the foils, but, you know, we also have to talk about the engine of the boat. I mean, the things that catch and propel it forward are also very important.
So,
you know, you only get 7 sails on board, and, you know, what you're asking of those sails is pretty important.
What is your personal pet peeve project, let's say, that you're mostly focusing on in, you know, kind of building the, you know, optimizing the use of the boat? Do you have any particular? I see you glowing a lot and smiling a lot when talking about this, so this is probably something that you're working on yourself also a lot. Is there any other particular area that you're really focusing on yourself and really having a lot of fun with yourself, as this is also a relatively new undertaking for you in this class?
Yeah, I think the sales stuff, to be honest, is very interesting. Because once you get the foils, you got your foils, you know, and you can only do so much with them. But you have a whole suite of sales. You have an inventory, and the rule is so open. It's not like you're sailing, TP52 that's been around for 20 years. And, you know, sail shapes are sail shapes, and you're talking about a small percent and camber change at, you know, the 3/4 stripe on a mainsail. I mean, you're talking about how big are we going to make this mainsail? Like how many square meters, you know, like what are the geometries? What are the crossovers? How versatile can we make these sails versus how specialized can we make these sails? For around the world race, you're optimizing an inventory around, the historical weather data, traditional routing, stopovers, all this kind of stuff. But in the ocean race, at least you get 14 sails. You know, how much redundancy do you put in the inventory versus how much specialization do you put in the inventory? It's for me that's the fascinating part.
Nice. Okay, well, final question. I mean, great interview so far. Can you share one really cool story from your own experience? I always ask this question in every interview, where you got yourself into a really dicey situation with the new boat and how you got yourself out of it. Because I guess people really love to hear those stories. So can you tell us something?
There was a 24-hour period in the TJV that didn't go quite according to plan. We were sailing a very good race, given the, I don't want to say limitations of the boat because it's a great boat, but it's a 16 boat, not a 20 boat. And I think at the time, Chiral was just kind of getting into the doldrums, and we were neck and neck with Pevia approaching the wind shadow of the Cabo Verdes. And everything went from, you know, JSA, as I like to say, just sailing along, to a complete nightmare. And basically, we had a little incident where we went to charge the engine with the seacock essentially closed. The water comes in from the keel, so it's not a seacock per se, but it's the engine had no water. Mm-hmm. And as a result, it shut down. We couldn't charge the batteries, and we ended up with a dead ship, and we were sailing a 60-foot Grand Prix yacht off a Velocitech compass that runs on AA batteries, and no autopilot, just one person hand steering with a tiller to 168, you know, I think was the heading or something like that. And I'm down below trying to fix the engine, and changed the impeller out, and I got the engine exhaust baffle disconnected, and this squall comes over, and the boat broaches with all the tools and engine parts completely, you know, scattered about. Sail tears in half, so we got to get that bad boy down again, just the two of us with no autopilot and the dead ship.
Yeah.
And finally get that thing corralled and have to do a sail change because of it. Wind shifts, we need to jibe, and sail bag falls overboard. And it was like, you know, we'd just gone from, you know, working real hard to put ourselves in a good position, had a sked, you know, in second place, kind of moving up toward the doldrums. And it was like just this 24-hour period of just complete hell. And, you know, the last two laps around the planet, I had the pleasure of sailing with a guy by the name of Nick Dana, who was kind of the boat captain, Mr. Fix-It, bowman type guy. And, you know, when the shit hit the fan previously, you just kind of like take care of it. And for me to have to deal with it all, by myself, I guess, was a new experience. But it ended just fine. Got the thing back on track. Weren't able to repair the sail over the course of the race, but it just goes to show you that you can go from just sailing along in the tropics to a complete and utter nightmare overnight. So, you know, that was probably the most trying experience we've had with the new boat. But, you know, I got 30, four more years of, you know, nightmares before that.
No, I'm sure we can talk for several more hours about sharing stories, but maybe we'll do that some other time. I guess we're out of time for today, but yeah, thanks for a great interview, Charlie. Really enjoyed the conversation, and I'm sure we'll do it again sometime later. Lots of luck, of course, with the new boat, and we'll be looking out for it when it comes out. I'm really curious to see it, and we'll be in touch. So thank you very much.
Sounds great. Thanks for having me. Take care.
So that was Charlie Enright from 11 Hour Racing Team. Also, check out their website here below. Definitely a super interesting team to keep track of, especially with the next season coming up and them so coming with a new boat. Very, very curious to see what that's going to be looking like and how it will do. So time to get in the situation, well, into the weather of today. Yesterday, we did a little bit of a small contest, let's say, in the comments with people predicting what the situation would be now on the leaderboards 24 hours later. And if we go there, we see that something quite unexpected. I think we had one person who you know, kind of predicted this, and that is that it's not Lewis Burton who has made a major comeback, but it's actually Thomas Roullion on Linked Out, who's gotten back into that second position. Now, as you can see, it's still very much open, but interestingly, there's a bit of a swiggle here in Lewis's path. And it's interesting that his average speed over 4 hours is very low. It's 12 knots, while both of the other gents are pushing 17 or 18. So, you know, I hope that everything is all right on board Lewis Burton's boat. But yeah, I don't know. Maybe the wind is so strong or the waves are so high that he's been having to slow down a little bit. Hard to say. But right now, average speed quite low. So I dare say that, looking at this distance, that if he had kept the speed that he was having previously, so, you know, 17, 18, 19 knots, you know, he obviously would have been more or less at the same position of a Pivia right now, definitely. But I guess for whatever reason, he had to hold back. So yeah, that's what it turned out to be. And so now Thomas Roullion in the second position, really cool. And we see that the rest of the field really tightening behind Apivia here. So the space used to be quite a bit bigger, but everybody, all of the foilers, you know, really getting into their stride. And yeah, in many ways, because the foilers have to, you know, hold back a little bit, and most of the non-foilers of the displacement boats can really go, you know, kind of full out. You know, it's kind of interesting what Charlie just said in the interview. Like, it's interesting to see the non-foiling boats kind of putting the pedal to the metal and just going 100% with the boat, while as we see, you know, foilers much more often hold back a little bit, especially if the wave state is big. They have that, you know, problem with them. Well, not problem, but the limitation with how much pressure they can put on the mast. So they have to be very aware of that and be careful on that front. So interesting to see how that develops. Now we have, of course, Jean Le Cam here still. I think he's in fifth position. No, in sixth position. And right behind there, we have, of course, several other boats. I'm looking where we have Boris. Ah, there he is on the Sea Explorer Yacht Club de Monaco. And the reason is that he had some problems yesterday night, and actually over the last 2 days, with the hydro generator. So he has these generators, basically propellers, that are thrown in the water to create power while he's sailing. And at very high speeds, these can actually get ripped clean off the boat, or they can overheat. And this is something that happened to them once during the Transat, which is a story that Will told me during the Imoca technology interview that I did with him earlier. And this actually happened to Boris twice over the last 48 hours or so. So he lost both of his hydro generators. Didn't actually completely lose them, but broke both of them. And so he's in the process of fixing those, but until then he has to turn off several of the systems on the boat, because he's basically not generating enough power now to keep everything running. So some little jazz going on there. Other than that, everything pretty much okay. It's interesting to see, though, that whole group has really come together. And we see a similar thing a little bit more down the line, where we see that Lucky 10, basically Armel Trepon, joining the group that was previously quite a distance ahead of them. So he used to be kind of a foursome with these three boats that you see behind, including Pip Hare, that were kind of together. Now he's kind of made the move and gone kind of up a group. So he's been, well, now of course less wind, but he's been really fast and moving forward through the fleet in a very, very impressive way. So yeah, I'm still curious to see if he can, you know, close another gap to that next group and then maybe at some point join the head of the race. I definitely wouldn't be surprised if that happened. Also behind we see, well, Pip and her little threesome here drifted apart a little bit more as, you know, the wind around them kind of falling apart. I hope that she doesn't get stuck in this hole, but that is moving to the east, so we'll have to see. But I think most exciting of all, look at the position of Jeremy Bijoux today. He is very close. I mean, for all intents and purposes, he's almost, you know, joining the aft group of the fleet again, which means that I think he has good wind now. So within 24 hours, I think most definitely he's going to, I think, get back with this group here and pass Merci, so Sebastian Destremaux first and then slowly on the rest of the group. And yeah, that means that one of the absolute race favorites from the start has made it back to the race. And psychologically for Jeremy, this must be a huge thing tomorrow, because he's been essentially racing completely on his own for 2 weeks. He's been the only one to completely race on his own for 2 weeks, just, you know, nobody behind him, nobody really in front of them, you know, nearby to the point where he could really race against them. It was just the entire fleet far, days and days ahead, and he's completely closed this gap now. So very, very impressive, and I'm very curious to see how he will progress through the fleet after that. So a quick look at the future. Let's see, so this is what we are looking at today with the fleet. And yeah, if we look at the next 24 hours or so, we see that those two low systems are generally going to, you know, predictably keep moving to the east at their own speed, which is real good news for the group in the front, because they're basically going to have the wind, you know, coming towards them from the back, so it'll give them lots of nice pressure. We see that this group in the middle, with Lucky 10 also, and with Pip Hare kind of on the other side, very wide system of very low variable wind. So again, a bit of a twist, because that's a little bit unusual again for this particular area. And yeah, I hope especially that the group that Pip is kind of in, so that's her, that's Dida Costa, and who else we have here, Manuel Cousin. I hope that they don't get, you know, stuck for 1 or 2 days in really almost no wind at all, but the chance of that happening are rather large. On the other side, the group that is behind there, so the group that has Chiral now and kind of the whole back of the fleet, good wind also, at least for the next 2 days or so, they can just keep on trucking. So that's very nice. And for the front also, I think the battle between Charlie and Lewis and Thomas is just going to keep going on. And we'll see how this kind of pack that has been gathering and inching closer behind them, how they might, you know, interfere and maybe have some contestants there wanting to try their luck now that we're in the Southern Ocean. So we'll see what kind of excitement that will bring over the next few days. Then let's take a quick look at the other race, the Jules Verne trophy, because yesterday something very interesting happened. Here, look, so As the boat kind of came, as Sodibo kind of came down, they had quite a lead. So this is about 2 days ago, and it looked very comfortably ahead of the old record, which is kind of the red boat here, the IDEX Sport. But over the course of yesterday, they had to tack quite a bit, And as you can see, the old record started to get really darn close. So this was when I was looking at the tracker yesterday, and I was kind of shocked how much the old record had gained on them, and they looked really, really close after they'd done so well. And I mean, this record is around the world in 40 days. I mean, the margin of error for the new team here trying to improve that record is so tiny that they really can't afford to make any major mistakes or have any real setbacks in the weather. Then they're just done for. So they're really racing on a razor's edge there. And so yesterday looked very, very dicey, but fortunately in the night their luck changed again and they had some good wind. And as we look tomorrow or this morning, we see that they've extended the distance between the two of them again quite a bit. Now, as far as latitude goes, they're not that much more south than the other boat. So it's not to say that this distance that they put in definitely puts them closer to the record, because they still have to make their way down. But as you can see, the weather prediction for now gives them good wind south. So I think that at least for the next 2 or 3 days, it looks like they will keep fairly easily ahead of the old record, as far as there is such a thing as easily staying ahead of a record of going around the world in 40 days. But for now, they seem to be in a good position, the crew of Sodebo Ultim 3. So that's kind of the state of the race in the Jules Verne. Okay, so that's it for the show today. I guess we went well over an hour already, so it's long enough for the Saturday. Thank you all again enormously for watching. Make sure to like and subscribe. Hit the bell button to make sure you get the update when the new show goes online. There are a lot of people emailing me saying that they have trouble to find the new episode every day, because apparently YouTube likes to sometimes randomize the videos and just kind of give you a Seawolves video where YouTube, because of their algorithm, says, well, you might like this particular Seawolf video, which is not the newest one. And apparently some people are actually having trouble finding the newest video. As far as I know, it should always be on top of the full episodes playlist. So that's always in order. I always put the newest video and premiere on top of that. And you can also find it on the website. So if you go to seawolvestv.com, there's a player on the homepage, the newest, latest video, also including the premiere from about an hour before the premiere. They're usually visible there, so you can click on it and you'll go into the waiting room for the premiere. You can always on top find the newest episode there. So I hope that helps for everybody to find the new live shows as they come on. So again, make sure to like, subscribe, hit the bell. If you want to become a backer or patron, help me do more amazing interviews like today. By the way, in 3 days I'm doing another interview, and this time we're going to do an interview in studio. So I'm actually going to be in the physical space together with the person that I'm interviewing. And I can already tell you that he's a former Vendee Globe racer who completed the race in the last edition. So that's all I will say. In 2 days I'll give you the actual name. The interview itself is in 3 days, so you can ask some questions for him then. But I'm really excited about it, and that's also largely, thanks to the fact that we have some patrons and people helping the channel to, set up those type of opportunities and do, an in-studio interview, for example, in this particular case. So it really helps, and I really appreciate you giving me the chance to build this channel and, invest in it a little bit and make this into something that's, I think, interesting for all of us and brings interesting conversations and topics, into the online sailing universe, let's call it. So thank you all very much for that. Go to the website seawolvestv.com for all the ins around that. And I guess we will see each other with a cup of fresh coffee tomorrow.